Welcome. Good afternoon. I'm Jeff Zack. I'm an assistant to the General President for Communications. And this workshop's being live streamed today through our website and our app as part of our Health, Safety, and EMS Conference that we're running here at National Harbor this week. So welcome to you in the audience and welcome to all those who are going to be tuning in through the internet. The topic for discussion is human trafficking, which is a form of modern slavery that occurs when one person exerts control over another person in order to exploit them economically. Victims of human trafficking are controlled through manipulation, violence, or the threat of violence, and they are not able to walk away from it. And more, firefighters and EMS providers are encountering these victims in their urban and suburban response. Dr. Suzanne Harrison, is here today, an associate professor at Florida State University. She's going to talk about the signs and symptoms that firefighters and paramedics can look for when responding to the public, and how you can appropriately connect these victims with the assistance they need. So, Dr. Harrison, it's all yours.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. So I really appreciate that you came out today to share this hour a little bit more with me to talk about something that's very near and dear to my heart, and that is taking care of these people that have been so disenfranchised from our society and from healthcare in general. So thank you for being here. I want this to be a very interactive session, so please stop me at any point and ask questions, offer stories to talk about what you may have encountered in the field. I'm not a first responder, so when I was thinking about scenarios that you might encounter, I realized I have a knowledge deficit and I'd really like to hear from you about what you're seeing. I think that will help me better educate some of the people that I work with, and I really want this to be a very interprofessional undertaking that as we all move forward. So today, he said, we're going to talk about human trafficking. I'm going to keep having to step behind the podium here to advance the slide, so I apologize for that. Because I guess you guys are getting continuing education, I think I need to say that I have no disclosures to make, no financial disclosures, no conflicts of interest, other than that I am the co-chair for Physicians Against the Trafficking of Humans, and I'm probably a little bit biased in favor of these victims and survivors that we deal with, and it's just really tragic. So I'm hoping that you can each take something away from this that will be helpful in your work. I also work at Florida State University College of Medicine, where I primarily teach medical students as part of my job, but we do a lot of interprofessional education. So maybe this will be helpful. My learning objectives for today are to review the definition of human trafficking, to identify risk factors, key indicators that you may see in the field, and other warning signs that someone may be a victim of human trafficking. I want to describe ways in which healthcare professionals can come in contact with victims of human trafficking. That's a little bit different for first responders than it is for physicians who may be in a clinic or an emergency room setting. But I think that the general gist of how we come in contact with people is salient to all of us, and we probably come in contact with victims of human trafficking outside of work almost as often as we do in work. So perhaps some of what I have to say will jog some memories and make you think, oh, well, what about that person? If even one of you recognizes something that you can take forward, I will have done my job today. I'm also going to provide some general guidelines for the approach to a trafficking victim. It's difficult and requires a little bit more time and a step back from the usual person that you might be responding to. I'll provide you with some resources both for your patients and for you as a healthcare professional. So what is human trafficking? In 2000, the United States enacted a law called the United States Victims of Trafficking and Violence Protection Act. This has since been renewed, but basically it defines severe forms of trafficking in humans as sex trafficking is when a commercial sex act is induced by fraud, force, or coercion, or when that person has not attained the age of 18. So basically, anybody who is below the age of consent and they're performing a sexual act, they are not really able to give consent. So that all by itself, if it's by fraud or coercion, is considered human trafficking. We'll go into that a little bit more later in more detail, and I want to get some audience participation as we do that. It also defines human trafficking as the recruitment or harboring and transportation or provision of obtaining a person for labor or services through fraud, coercion, or force for the purposes of involuntary servitude, peonage, debt bondage, or slavery. So, you know, we thought we were past the age of slavery, but we're really not. It's just taken on a different form in 2015 than it did so many years ago, and I think we really need to pay attention to this again. Any questions about this legal definition? Has everybody seen this before? Yes?
A question. Does this include taking advantage of drug addiction?
Actually, that's a really great question. So his question was about drug addiction and how that plays into this. So one of the means that traffickers use to coerce people is to get them addicted to drugs before they start selling them. And so that's a way of keeping them enslaved, is to get them addicted to drugs. That also makes it more difficult for you to do your job because you don't know how that happened and where they got there. And it's sometimes difficult to sort all of that out in the, you know, the emergency of the moment. So how big a problem is this? Well, we know that there's more than 20 million people living in slavery worldwide. The number's probably closer to 28 or 29 million at this point, but we don't have a new report yet. We know that there are 600,000 to 800,000 people trafficked across international borders every year. One of the things that I find most sobering is that 85% of the people that are trafficked in this country are U.S. citizens. So when we think of trafficking, we often think of the people that are coming in across the borders who've been sold into slavery and brought here against their will, but that's not who most of them are. Most of them are women and children that have been trafficked geographically in the United States, some of them not even very far outside their neighborhoods. So these are really vulnerable people that have been initially recruited, molded, coerced, and it takes a while before we get there, as I'll describe a little bit later. So when we think about trafficking, we need to think outside of just that non-English speaking person that you're worried has been brought across the border, but somebody who may be just in a different county, maybe in a different county in Michigan. So according to the Center for Exploited Children, there's 100,000 to 300,000 U.S. children that are at risk every year in this country of being sex trafficked. And the average age of entry into the commercial sex trade is 12 to 14 for girls and 11 to 13 for boys. These are really young, middle-aged school kids, right? So really, can they give consent? I don't think they can. And most of them are U.S. citizens. These are the kids that are most vulnerable, and they're the ones that I am really most concerned about. You'll notice that I said commercial sex trade because there's a lot of debate going on right now about what is prostitution, what is trafficking. We're going to come back to that a little bit later, and I really want to hear what you guys think about that issue right now, especially with the New York Times article and Amnesty International's declaration that they think all sex trade should be legalized. That was just this week. Okay, so this is what sex trafficking looks like in the United States right now. Are most of you from the places in the middle where there isn't quite as much? Or are you from the borders where there's a lot, right? Well, I'm from Florida. That's where I'm living now. And it's almost all orange, as you can see. It's really awful. And if you look on the eastern seaboard, you know, from DC on up, you'll see that it's all really heavily trafficked. You've got a lot of trafficking in the Seattle-Portland area, down in California, but you also see hotbeds around Chicago, Detroit, actually most of Michigan. This is just the United States, it's not Canada and Mexico. Because Polaris is really, I mean, they do international stuff too, but their job is the United States. So take a look at where your home is. It's happening there too. Okay, I've got four videos that I want to show you today. They were designed for physicians, so I apologize for the fact that it says physician over and over again in these videos. But as I look at them, I realize that it really doesn't make any difference which healthcare professional we're talking to. We're really all on the same team in trying to fight this. So I apologize for what we said in the videos when we developed them initially. We're working on that. But we've got a little bit of AV trouble, so I'm going to pull up, take the PowerPoint down and pull up the video, because even though they're embedded, they don't seem to work. Okay.
My name is Dr. Kanani Tichen. This video is designed to provide information about a very vulnerable patient population, patients who are victims of sex trafficking in the United States. These videos are designed to provide educational information about the scope of the problem here in the United States, tools for screening and intervention, intervention strategies, and for providing information and resources to your patients. It is important to realize that these videos are not comprehensive in nature. Although they contain vital information, we hope that these videos will inspire physicians to seek more education and to connect to other resources in their communities. Thank you very much for watching.
During the time I was trafficked, I did see doctors. I would visit local health clinics, dental clinics, and I would also go to the children's hospital.
Sex trafficking of young people is happening in every single state and the District of Columbia. So it's a major, major problem.
The US State Department says that there are over 20 million people involved in some sort of trafficking around the world.
I am a trafficking survivor. I was first trafficked when I was 13, and I got out of it when I was 21.
One of the statistics that shocks me the most is that the average age at which girls enter the commercial sex industry is around 12 to 14.
Kids are just entering puberty, and that's when traffickers are preying upon them. And to think at that, 12 and 13 years of age, that's 8th to 9th grade.
I was 14 when I was first trafficked, and I was 17 when I left the lifestyle.
Now, I don't happen to believe girls that age actually choose to be in this industry. In fact, what trafficking is modern day slavery.
I didn't really see myself as a sex trafficking victim until I was around 20 or 21. I didn't really realize, because when I was working on the street, you really feel more like a criminal than you do a victim.
Part of the way we need to shift our thinking on this is to stop thinking of these girls as prostitutes or hoes.
I think the biggest kind of prejudice is this idea of choice, and the idea around kind of who's a deserving victim, who's a real victim. I think we're comfortable on some level with the idea of a trafficking victim who is chained to a wall and kept in a basement.
Most children that fall in sex trafficking are not kidnapped. These are kids that could be just walking to school from home, and they are approached.
They were lied to. They were told that they were going to be having a better life, that they were gonna get everything they wanted, dresses, money, shoes, everything, and they end up having sex for $40.
They conned you into this life using tactics of love, using tactics of brutality.
Any race, ethnicity, class, religion, it can happen to any person.
Sex trafficking doesn't discriminate, they take white girls, black girls, Mexican girls, any type of girls. They take girls. They don't care. All they want is girls.
I think doctors have a certain idea of what a trafficking victim is. They think it's usually somebody who's a minority, or somebody who's from another country, or somebody who has no family or in foster care. So I think that it didn't really enter their mind, even as I was more open about what was happening.
Even if it happened just to one child, it's a child too many.
My name is Dr. Kanani Tichen. This video is designed.
Okay, any questions or thoughts about that before we go on? Okay, so why are these kids and these young people being trafficked? What's the economic indicator? What's the economic driver for this? Poverty for the people that are being trafficked. That's how they get lured into this. That's good. Trafficking is more profitable. Trafficking of humans is more profitable than trafficking of drugs or guns. These people can be sold over and over and over again. And then they can be sold to another trafficker if they've been, excuse this, but used up enough that they're not marketable in that geographic location anymore. So it's really the act of recruitment. These kids get recruited by Leela, who was the first survivor that you saw on the video. She was lured into trafficking by someone who posed as her boyfriend. You know, I can get you this, I can get you this. Here's your cell phone, something that her biological family couldn't afford, and so got lured into this. And I remember one young woman who told me that, you know, she thought she was in this great relationship and, you know, was having sex with this guy, really, you know, she had clothes, she had a phone, she had a place to live, she had enough food. And then one night he asked her to have sex with his friends. And she didn't want to do that, but after a week or two of trying to coerce her into that, she ended up doing it. And what he said to her was, well, you know, you do it for free with me, why not do it for somebody else? We need food. This is how we can get money. And so it's a slow, insidious process that starts out seemingly innocent. And it isn't until they're caught up into it that they really traffic them and pimp them out. It doesn't happen right away. But there has to be some manipulation, some coercion. There can be abduction. It depends on who we're talking about. But there's some deception involved in getting them there. And the comment about the drug use is really important because that is often how you get people almost enslaved. So you get them hooked to drugs and then their only means of getting more drugs is through their trafficker. And I just want to point out the economics of this are astronomical. So who's at risk? Kids and young people who've been sexually abused as children are at biggest risk, those who've been sort of disenfranchised. We know that 85% of the young women in this country that are US citizens that have been trafficked, this is not 85% of all kids in foster care, but 85% of the ones who have been trafficked were in the foster care system. So, you know, we worry about getting these kids out of these horrible environments where they're growing up, but we also have to remember the horrific, sometimes horrific environment that they might end up in and what that can do to them. So we want to make sure that we are empowering them and not putting them into an equally adverse environment. Right. So they, you know, not all foster homes are created equally. Some of them are loving, wonderful places to be, and some of them are group homes, and some of the foster parents are the traffickers. So, you know, we have a paucity of people who are willing to be foster parents in this country, and so, you know, there's not enough money to investigate everybody and to make sure that we're sending these kids into good places. So I'm not saying we should leave them in bad environments. I'm saying we need to look at our system a little bit better. How many of you guys are from the United States as opposed to outside the country? Who's, you didn't raise your hand. Where are you from?
Florida.
That's still. So what the point that I'm trying to make here is these kids are at risk. These are vulnerable kids, and that is how they get lured into this. So it's not all, as Angela said on the video, it's not all the kids being abducted, although that does happen too. But the kids that are abducted tend to be younger or from outside this country. And so these kids, it's a slow, insidious process. And then sometimes the traffickers will move them from one community to another, sort of disorient them. And that helps keep them secluded. Okay, got another video for you. So, can you play these from over there? You can't, can you?
I've been doing this for 14 years. I've worked with a lot of human trafficking victims over the years, and not a single one of them ever said, I'm a victim of human trafficking, I need help.
We know that trafficked individuals come in contact with the medical profession quite a bit through emergency rooms, clinics, OBGYN clinics, family practice, internal medicine. So we're on the front lines, but we're missing it.
The doctors knew that I was having sex with older men, and they knew that I was in multiple situations where I was beaten up, but they didn't put together that I was a trafficking victim.
There isn't an easy way to say these are the like five things that you need to be looking for, right? There are obviously clothing that is weather or situationally inappropriate.
Bruising or scars, burns, cuts, especially those in non-apparent places that may be hidden. Repeated STD or pregnancy, fearful, anxious, or depressed mood. Certainly if the patient pays with cash and has no health care, that can be a warning sign. Patient may appear malnourished. A third party may speak in place of the patient and not allow the patient to speak. Substance addiction or the appearance of withdrawal of a substance can be telling. Frequently, patients will lie about their age. And the patient may also say that she's just visiting or passing through an area, and that should be cause for concern.
Trafficking victims are frequently tattooed with the name of their trafficker, or the trafficker has some kind of tag that's an identifying tag, so that if the victim tries to run away, she can be readily identified by other pimps as the property of her trafficker.
Just make sure you're paying as much attention as you can, because sometimes these girls are going through very difficult times and you would never know. And they want to speak out, but they're too scared.
I didn't really feel safe talking about it, because for me in the medical field has always, whenever there's anything that's remotely criminal, there's always police involved, and I don't have good experiences with the police.
As long as she feels safe and she knows she's not gonna get in any trouble, you can have her speak about a lot. If I was just been able to feel safe and comfortable, I think I would have spoke out.
The moments that you feel like something is off here, or I'm uncomfortable with the answer, I'm uncomfortable with the body language or the look she's giving me as she answers this question, you don't get those when you ask about, you know, are you having nausea or vomiting?
So how do we start screening? You might ask questions like, is the patient comfortable? Attend to their immediate needs, provide clothing if they need it. Is there someone here with you today? Can we talk alone safely? Do you have a place to stay? Who are you living with? Where are you living? Do you feel safe? Has anybody ever hit you or forced you to do something that you don't want to do? An important question to ask is, do you work, live, and sleep in the same place? Have you ever traded anything for sex? Food, shelter, money?
If I was a doctor and I'd be asking questions, my first question would be, are you okay? It seems like a dumb question or just simple, but sometimes it can make you break down and really think about it, because if somebody would ask me if am I okay, I would have actually broke down.
If a healthcare provider asks the right questions in an environment that's not judgmental, and where a message is being communicated that this is being asked to help the individual, in many cases, a victim will be able to disclose what her experience has been.
If a young person does decide to disclose, you're not shocked to everything that they're saying and reacting in the moment, because a young person doesn't take that as, goodness, you need some more training around this issue. They take it as, you're reacting to me, you're disgusted by me, right? You're shocked by what I'm telling you.
The judgmental look is very powerful. It might not be to some people, but it makes you feel very small, very like you're not needed, like you're just disgusting.
It's also important to avoid words that may be stigmatizing, such as prostitute, and to maintain an open manner and a compassionate manner rather than one that's closed and judgmental when talking with these patients. Many of these patients are not in control of their own bodies or their own lives, so it's important to meet them where they are, to receive whatever information they have to give us, and then to receive that information in a non-judgmental manner without disgust, and showing instead compassion and understanding. In doing so, in restoring the humanity to these patients, we stand a better chance of receiving information more quickly that may be of more help to our patients.
I've been doing this for 14 years. I've worked with a lot of human trafficking victims over the years.
Okay. Thoughts before I move on. How many of you have cared for a person who you wondered might be trafficked? Do you want to tell us about that? Can you get him a mic so they can capture this? I'm sure that's not what he wants, but.
Well, there's a couple cases that came to mind. I work in downtown Seattle, and we have a pretty significant drug problem there, mm-hmm. Open drug markets and things. And I see, you know, the malnutrition, I just a really, really slender young African-American woman. I'd see her repeatedly just strung out in the street and in, an, you know, no stable place, mm-hmm. tattoos, I mean, just the whole nine yards. The other one that was a lot clearer. One that's not so clear to me.
Can I stop you before you go on?
Sure.
So you've interacted with this young woman more than one time.
Yeah.
Right. What did you do?
We sent her to the emergency room.
Did you communicate with the emergency room personnel what your concerns were?
No. It was just her immediate physical needs.
Which were.
Her place to detox, get some fluids, and you know, kind of just get her head straight.
Okay, all right. Didn't mean to interrupt you. Go on with your second story.
And I've seen a couple of guys. One in particular. He was a soldier back from Iraq, mm-hmm. and I think he got addicted to pain meds there, and. Because he got blown up, mm-hmm. and then the only way he could feed that addiction was, you know, going into sex clubs and offering up his body, and so he'd just go in there, and then he'd come out 3 days later with absolutely no recollection of what happened, and then go to the hospital, and then just repeat that cycle over and over again. So I wonder, you know, the drug addiction was pre-existent. This is how he fed the habit, but he was clearly being exploited. So that's the question I have.
And the lines get really blurry, you know. Mm-hmm. So, you know, at what point do you say that he's being exploited, and what point was it voluntary because he was feeding his habit? The underlying problem was his drug addiction and homelessness, and so that's really what we need to deal with. But we have to acknowledge these other parts of it to be able to deal effectively with what's going on. He has to get money somehow, right?
Mm-hmm.
But clearly, he was not in control of what was happening to him. And the same with the young woman. I think it's difficult to know what to do in these situations, and you all are on the front lines. You're the ones that see these patients in the context of where they're living, whether it's, you know, down in Pioneer Square or somewhere else. You're seeing them where they live. And as physicians, we're on the other side of it, so maybe in the emergency room at Harborview, and we don't, you know, we can envision what it might be, but we don't really see it. And I think that allows us to be able to distance ourselves in a way that may not be helpful for our patients. So I would say that we rely on you guys to tell us what you're really finding and what you're thinking, even if you can't prove it, even if you've just got that sense that there's something else. And like Leela said, maybe just say, are you okay? I think it's dangerous when we get into the situation of trying to rescue them, because these people have had all elements of control taken from them. And so we need to empower them and give them decision-making capabilities in any possible way that we can. When is that too far? I don't know. I think it's different in every situation, and you're going to have to rely on yourselves to know where that line is and when you do something more.
We are all mandatory reporters in the state of Florida. Everybody's a mandatory reporter. The state laws are different in every situation for minors, but you've got these kids telling you that they're, you know, 19, 20, 21, and you look at them and you think, no, you're 13. You're 14 years old, and so what do you do? Do you believe the age? What about the person who doesn't have any documentation? Because sometimes those are taken from them as a way of control. So what are you gonna see? You talked about the tattoos, so I'm gonna start there because some of these tattoos are brands. Now, I've actually even seen somebody who had a barcode scan tattooed, and they can actually scan those and then return them to their pimps. But you might see a dollar sign tattooed in somebody's groin. What person puts a dollar sign in their own groin? Somebody did that to them. This one says property of general, so that's the name of her pimp or her trafficker. And I am going to use the terms interchangeably here because I think that line gets blurry there too. So you might see somebody who has unusual infections. You might not be diagnosing those in the field, but you certainly all have enough healthcare experience and knowledge to know when you're seeing something that's seemingly unusual. You might see a kid that has measles or chickenpox and, you know, a young adult, and they should have been immunized against that. So does that mean they're immunocompromised, or does that mean they were not allowed to get their vaccines? People who have multiple sexually transmitted infections over and over and over again, do they not have access to barrier protection? Do they not know how? Are they not being allowed to use it? Do they not have the means to get it? Do they have a resistant organism that isn't amenable to the antibiotics that are given to them when they go to urgent care or a street clinic or the emergency room? In the clinic setting, we sometimes see people who have multiple complaints that seem to be arising from stressors and some more somatic stuff, and then you kind of wonder what else is going on in their lives, what is happening to them that would cause them to be complaining about these things. A lot of abdominal pain, a lot of GYN complaints, headaches, sometimes from repetitive closed head injuries, might see that. You mentioned malnutrition. Really common. So it costs a lot to feed people and to feed people nutritious meals. That doesn't happen when they're holding people captive. So they might be fed enough to get by, but it certainly won't be a well-balanced, healthy diet with three meals a day. So you're going to see a lot of dehydration and a lot of malnutrition, especially when there's drug abuse involved. You might see multiple pregnancies because people don't have the ability to use contraception. And you might see women, I don't know where all of you work, but I have taken care of women who came in for abortions when they didn't want to have an abortion and there was a man there with them insisting that that happen. And so that's actually how we found one trafficking ring down in South Florida is this woman who came in for an abortion and realized what was going on. Yes?
So if they're branded
how do they finally get out?
Yeah.
So that's a really good question. So how do people get out of the situation eventually? The two young women that you see on the video were both trafficked for a number of years before they finally got out. Sarah for a lot longer than Leela. I think she was they call it in the life. How many of you have heard that? Yeah, they call it in the life. I think Sarah was in the life for 7 or 8 years before, and she repeatedly tried to get out of it. But then she would end up back, part of it with drug abuse, part of it because she was discovered by another pimp and then sent back to her original pimp. And they transport them all over the place, the New York to Miami, and New York to Orlando. Trafficking ring is pretty efficient, and they send these girls and young men back and forth all the time. So they recognize the tattoos and they send them back, or they keep them and use them for a while and then send them back. How did they get out eventually? If we offer them enough opportunity to be empowered, to understand what's going on, and then choose when they leave, I think we have a better chance of actually getting them out of the life. Leela is completely out of the life and is actually going to come and speak. We have a multi-interprofessional summit planned for the middle of September, and Leela is actually coming to the summit to talk to these governmental and medical people about what it was like. So probably love to have IAFF represented at that summit, but it's pretty powerful when you listen to their stories. You've all dealt with victims of domestic violence. Take that and magnify it by 100. I mean, this is what they're living in. They have no hope, no way to get food, no way to get money, no way to shelter themselves, and they're branded. They're owned. Yes, you and then you.
I have a couple instances where I picked up girls that are in their early to mid-teens, mm-hmm. and their behavior didn't seem to gel with where they should be at developmentally in that age group. And when I say that, what I mean is it's almost that you can sense that they're trying to establish a bond with you almost overtly. And I always wonder, is that, you know, something you see often in these kids that are sex trafficked, that where they're, you know, because teens don't normally, having raised two teenage daughters, they don't really want anything to do with adults for the most part. And we deal with these girls that they're almost like, you know, drawn to you as a stable, you know, they see you as some sort of stable role model, so their behavior just doesn't gel with where they should be developmentally. Is that something you see?
Yes. So their interactions are primarily with adult men, and yet you are an adult man who's not trying to exploit them, right? But so there's some learned behavior that goes along with that, and I think that may partly be what you're seeing, and then it may partly also be the learned behavior of being overly sexual, because that's part of their job. What do you do about that? I think that if you sense that they really trust you, you may be the person that can make the bigger difference than anybody else. You're a man who's not trying to exploit them, so you may even be more powerful than a woman in the same position if you're able to get through to them. It takes a long time to engage trust, and you must exude a presence that says, I'm trustworthy, and so they feel comfortable talking to you. And I think when you're in that situation, you can ask them questions. If you don't always have to act on everything. I realize that you're a mandatory reporter, but if you criminalize their behavior, then you can't do anything to make a difference and to get them out of the life. So I think that we have to realize that this line is kind of gray. Does that help?
Yeah.
What was your question?
Just talking about the branding and the tattoos and getting out of it. A dear friend of mine does a lot of charitable work with gangs and mm-hmm. things like that have tattoos, and he does removal of the tattoos, doctor. Mm-hmm. And it's just a little step towards making them a little safer in life and giving them another chance, a fresh start.
That's wonderful. And where do you live?
I'm in the Lower East Side of Manhattan, okay. And I think it's a national program that they use. Dr. Ores, O-R-E-S.
O-R-E-S?
Yeah. And I think right now he's looking for another machine. They're pretty expensive, but it's all charity-based. So.
Wow, that's wonderful. Yeah. Thank you for sharing that. Okay, so you may also, with the people that are not sex trafficked, this is not all sex trafficking. There's a lot of labor trafficking going on too, so I don't want to belabor just one side of it. But you might see some unusual occupational injuries in the field too. So really think about how this could have happened. What is the response to, you know, EMS showing up and trying to assist with an injury or something else that may have happened? And does the response make sense? Or does it seem kind of off from what you might expect? And I think give yourself permission to ask questions in those settings. So what are the red flags? They're really the same as any other abuse, except taken a magnitude further. So the usual inconsistent, or often in these cases, very scripted histories. So these young people, when they come to a hospital setting or when EMS is called, they've been told by their pimp or trafficker what to say. They won't know the answers to the questions that are not part of their script. If you get that sense, that should raise your suspicion. They may be unable to give an address or not know their current city. There was a woman who was brought before a judge in Michigan about, I think this was about a year ago, but I might be getting my dates wrong, for prostitution, and she was in front of the judge. The judge asked her where she lived, and she said Orlando. She was in Detroit. And that was how they found her. That was how they figured out what was going on, because that particular judge was astute enough to realize there's something wrong here, I need to ask more questions. So if you find a minor trading sex for anything, anything of value, which is probably a lot of what you are dealing with in your example, really think about, why do they have to do that? Why are they in a situation that requires them to do that to be able to survive? And what can I do to help them? Help them out of that situation, or even help them temporarily, even if it's just giving them food, a coat, a blanket, anything. If a person's had an unusually high number of sexual partners, we don't always, you guys probably don't always get to that level of detail in your histories out in the field, but for those of you who might be ER docs and medical directors of some of the EMS programs, you're getting that level of history. So an unusually high number of sexual partners in a 14-year-old really should raise your suspicion that there's something else going on. And rather than making her feel guilty or like she's promiscuous, think, why is this happening? Because that is not normal adolescent behavior. Somebody's coming in with an illness that's a really late presentation, or you know, you get called out and they're really sick and you think, well, they should have gone in for assistance sooner. Think about why they might not have been allowed to get help sooner than that. In the field, you probably won't see this, but I always worry when I see a young person carrying around a large amount of cash and yet they don't have the ability to spend that. That makes me worried about where they got the cash. And then, as always, the kids that say that they're older than they are, and you know better. So control indicators. And this is actually where I wanna hear from you, because I'm not out in the field, I'm not a first responder, and so I really wanna hear about what you're seeing. When you get called and you're worried about somebody and yet there's a person who's answering all the questions for them. There's a person who's not allowing the patient to answer or who's interrupting or correcting. Or the kid who's texting all the time and seems to be afraid. What are you seeing? And what are you seeing in those people that seem more controlling? Are you seeing something different than I am? What do you do?
You know, usually what we'll do is we'll have somebody take that person or attempt to take that person and move them away from the situation so that we can get that that victim or the patient, however you want to term it, to answer the questions rather than out of the person that's trying to control the situation. There's a lot of ways that you can do it, and quite frankly, there's quite a few instances where you just can't get them to leave the side, but you know, you make an attempt and obviously try to be somewhat covert about it. But
so educate me a little bit. What are the ways in which you separate people? I want to know if they're different than what I do.
We'll ask, say, if it's an adult, when we're dealing with a minor, we'll ask the adult, hey, I have some questions that I would need to ask you that I don't want them to hear. Can you come out to the kitchen with me? You know, and so you get that, and then there's kind of an understanding with the crew when you remove that person that that's your opportunity to kind of, you know, mm-hmm. do a little deeper digging on that patient. And it works quite, you know, frequently if you can come up with a creative, mm-hmm. Non-threatening way to ask that person to step away. And then, you know, you don't really need that much time to get information out of that person. Once that person that's controlling them is removed from the scene, they'll usually open up pretty quickly. So
that means you've got a trusted partner that's going to ask the right questions
right.
when you're in the other room.
Yeah.
What questions do you ask of the person who you find controlling?
The controller or the victim?
The controller.
The controller, you know, it's usually something completely off base, you know. You know, we'll take him aside and says, you know, she doesn't seem like, you know, she's acting quite right. Have you noticed any strange other behavior? You know, is there anything? So, I mean, it's very vague. Somewhat
misleading questions as to where we're
but
going.
But a way to give them control.
Yes, exactly. It gives them control, and a lot of the times you can put them in a situation where you're asking them these questions, and they feel like by talking to you, they're actually maintaining control over the situation,
right.
Not realizing that we're in the other room, aware of maybe what's going on and getting a whole different story. So.
Okay, well, thank you for sharing mm-hmm. that. Anybody else? I really want to hear from you because I want to learn from you because I'm going to use all that I learn in other sessions. So if you don't want to talk on the microphone, come and talk to me afterwards. Other elements, you guys know this, but you know, people that are not in control of their own identification, whether it's a United States citizen or somebody else, I always worry about that a little bit. People who seem afraid and their eyes are downcast, they're not making eye contact with you, they're only mumbling a little bit, a word here or there, I always worry about what is going on. Doesn't mean they're being trafficked. It could mean they're being trafficked. Certainly, they're being controlled by somebody, right? And then just that hypervigilance, answering texts, that sort of thing, anything that makes you suspicious. Okay, another video. I think this is our third one.
These are not easy interventions. It's not a matter of identifying someone and picking up the phone and calling 911. In fact, these are situations that can be fairly complicated and complex.
When I was 13, I had to get stitches, and the doctors realized what was happening, and the police were called, and they didn't even ask me whether the police should be called. They just showed up, and the police were really, really adversarial about it.
So trust is key, and if a doctor can continue to communicate, we are concerned about you, we want to help you, we're not going to force you to do anything you don't want to do, including call the police, then it gives the patient a space to believe that these are people who can really care about her and possibly provide the assistance she needs to move on.
It's important that they know that there are risks that go along with them sharing, and hopefully the benefit outweighs those risks, but you do have a responsibility to let them know that there are times when you are a mandatory reporter. We know that we need to always make sure our patients know that what they're telling us is being kept confidential.
Some physician may ask the young person, do you want your boyfriend to leave the room? And the young person, especially if they're being sex trafficked, they will be afraid to say yes.
The best practices include providing that protection even before anyone else is called in. At the moment a doctor thinks someone is a trafficking victim, change the patient's name in the records, provide an alias. So I sometimes have been called to the emergency room to meet with a specific patient where I was given a name, and now I've been told at reception, well, there's no one by that name here. And that's actually great.
In terms of what might be safe or unsafe, if they're kind of like looking out the corner of their eye at this guy and they say, no, I'm not with him, but right, like pay attention, be observant about those things.
Initially, everyone wants to save these kids or rescue the kids. We talk about all the time, we don't rescue anybody, we assist kids because they have to actively be a part of this.
I think that impulse to rescue is very normal and really harmful. And can be really problematic for somebody's kind of long-term recovery and healing that has to be about them.
I also think that there is no one right thing that you're going to do. There isn't something you can say or some magic thing you can do that tomorrow is going to change that girl's life.
The girls I know, they all wanted to finish school. They all wanted to be somebody, do something in life. We would always sit around and talk. And we would always just say, "Oh, well, we're gonna go out of this. We're gonna beat this disease. We're gonna stop getting high. We're gonna be singers. We're gonna be actresses." I know that they all wanted to do something. It's just the drugs and the life was holding us back.
As physicians, we are trained to act and we're trained to solve problems. And it's important in these situations to remember that we are not going to fix this person's life in one visit. Many of these patients have been in their situation for years, and many times the path to recovery is a long one, and we are one stepping stone in that path. It's important then to listen to our patients, to provide the information that they need, the resources that they need, and it's important for us as physicians to know what those resources are. Who are the people that we're sending these patients to? How will they be treated in the community? And lastly, it's important for us to respect our patients' privacy and to make sure that other people respect our patients' privacy.
These are not easy interventions.
Okay. Questions about that? Sorry that it says physicians. Yes.
So I know I've, on small kids, asked where, where the kids go to school at or something, just to try to establish a rapport. Just sitting here thinking, would that be something maybe to these kids, in the junior high, early high school age, what school do you go to, and just kind of get a feeling of if they're going to school, if they're not, and which presents a question I was going to ask you, if they are being trafficked, do they go to school?
Sometimes they do. They're usually not doing very well in school, and they might not be going to school where they went before. But so not all traffickers are evil people they don't know. Some of the traffickers are family members, close friends, and so those kids may actually still be in school. It's the demeanor, and it's your sense of, is there something else going on, and then do I need to delve deeper into this? That's what I want you to understand, to ask more questions. I think saying, do you go to school, is a great question. If somebody looks away or doesn't answer or mumbles something under their breath, that might be a good clue that they're not going to school, and that's something that would be really important for you to know. Any way that you can engage them and get a rapport going, I think will help. And every child, every person who's being trafficked, regardless of what the story is going to have a different story and a different angle. Something different is going to work for every person. So trust your gut. I really find that some of these questions are, the open-ended, let's ask a question and see what they say, are really the best way to uncover something. I don't always know what it is. I actually got into this work primarily through my work with domestic violence and child abuse, and it's sort of then led to more work with child sexual assault and then eventually with human trafficking. And so these are the kinds of questions that I ask, is just, are you okay? And then kind of see how they react. And then just ask the next most obvious question. I think the less scripted we are in the way we care about these people and care for these people, the more likely we are to be successful. So there's no magic set of questions. We've talked a lot about what we do. These are not easy patients, clients. What do you guys call them in your line of work? What are they called?
Patients.
Okay, good. We're all on the same team. I can call them patients. They come at this from a different perspective than we do. I grew up in a really kind of average, middle class upbringing, with one educated parent, one not educated parent, but I had a good life, nothing out of, it's still really boring. But that's what allowed me to get where I am. But some of these kids have not had that same experience, and they don't disclose what's happening to them. They're ashamed, they're fearful. They're fearful of retaliation. There's often language barriers. Even if it's not an English language, some other language, it may be a dialect thing. It may be that they're from a different part of the country and they speak differently than you do, and so there's still a language barrier there. They have such a short amount of time with people who might care for them that they don't have time to develop trust. So we have to maximize the time that we do have with them. They may not want to be rescued. This may be better than where they came from, if that's even possible to imagine. Or they perceive it that way because now they have food and shelter. They may identify with their abusers, with their traffickers, with their pimps. They may think their pimps are their boyfriends because this is their first ever relationship and they don't know any better. they may have criminal records, and so they may be afraid of you, maybe afraid of me, maybe afraid of what the police are going to do to them, to take them and put them in jail or put them in some other shelter that may be worse than where they've been. And they have a lot of past traumas, so they're carrying all that baggage with them. It makes them sometimes difficult to deal with. It makes them resistant. Sometimes it makes them confrontational. Sometimes they're addicted to drugs. And once in a while, our own baggage and all of the experiences that we've had gets in the way. And we can be short with people, not you guys, but me, can be short with people, can be maybe less engaging, less patient. And so when you sense that, just take a step back. We all have people that we deal with more effectively than others. And when you're handing them off, like, you know, when you were talking about taking people to the emergency room in Seattle, try somehow to communicate with the person who's going to be caring for them on the other end about what you're worried about, even if it's not the obvious medical condition that's being treated. Because sometimes that underlying stuff is more important. So tips for interviewing them: engage their trust, be as non-judgmental as possible, and that flashing look of disgust that might come across somebody's face, we just have to put it away. And we all have biases. We just have to check them at the door. I continually uncover more and more of my own all the time, and I'm sometimes very surprised that I didn't know I felt that way about this or that. But I think when you discover them in yourselves and when you've had an encounter and you think that didn't go very well, try to reflect a little bit in the tiny little bit of spare time you have between things about what happened and why that might have happened and what you're bringing forward from your past. Understand that sexual victimization is a learned behavior. It's not really a choice. It's what they've been taught, and it's the way they get by. And so their behavior may be very inappropriate, and that might push your buttons. But see these people as victims rather than offenders, rather than criminals. Some of the kids and young people may fear deportation if they're a foreign national and not a U.S. citizen. They may not have their identification with them, and they might think that you're on the team that's going to deport them. That's probably not the case for most of you. You probably really don't care. But some people do, and some of these kids are really afraid of that. Even if they're not afraid of that, they may distrust law and authority, like Sarah was talking about in the video. They're also not aware of their rights, and again, they don't identify themselves as a victim, so if they don't identify as a victim, they really don't know that they have any rights, and they do have rights. The laws, there are laws in all 50 states and the District of Columbia now, anti-trafficking laws, so these kids do have rights, and there are different avenues for dealing with this, whether they're U.S. citizens and domestics or whether they're foreign nationals. This slide is to really talk, and this is really about the kids that are sex trafficked and the young people, whether they're, you know, some of them transitioning into adulthood as well. Sarah was 21 before she got out, so she was an adult by the time she finally really got herself into recovery. These are national averages that these people, both boys and girls, are having 30 sexual encounters a day. So they have 30 Johns. In South Florida, where in Florida are you from?
Fort Lauderdale.
Fort Lauderdale. So in South Florida, they have the average is 45 a day. The Johns have 15 minutes with 50. They have 15-minute appointments. They're working 7 days a week, and so that really amounts to like 210 rapes or more per week. Now they don't have time to process any of that. When a person is raped, and it is not a trafficking situation, you know, they're brought to care, they get counseling, they get an evaluation, people rally around them, the victim advocates come, and they have time to process. It's a horrible, horrible experience for them. It's awful. Some of the injuries are terrible, but they have time to process. This is 210 times a week. There's no time to process. So the trauma is just multiplied and multiplied, and that complex trauma is so hard to deal with. They have PTSD as bad as some of our war veterans do, sometimes worse. They're like torture victims. So our approach to them has to keep that in mind. They're not normal people anymore. They've lost that sense of self. They have no hope. They don't see themselves as individuals anymore. They see themselves as a piece of property. And imagine this is going on for years. Okay, last video.
It's important for us as physicians to provide resources for our patients. If we can't do this in person, then we really need to provide pamphlets and have posters in our clinic that specify resources for sex trafficking.
One thing that has helped me open up over time was seeing pamphlets about sex trafficking and seeing, just reading them in the hospital. I've seen them in hospitals. And it doesn't necessarily make you talk to the doctor right away, but it makes you realize that it is something that people may understand. And it makes you, while reading it, it makes you realize the situation that you're in and the help that is available.
If they are ready to get help, you know, you ask things like, do you want to speak with one of our social workers? Or do you need the phone number of a safe place to stay? Or can I walk you over to the emergency room where somebody might be able to get in contact with security or child protective services? Or, you know, can I help you in some way?
Was there somebody growing up who you felt like you could turn to and you felt safe with? Maybe we could call that person and see if they could come to the hospital tonight and pick you up.
And you know what? Maybe give the kids some food, because chances are if they're really out there in the life and caught up in the street, they haven't eaten.
If you are going to prescribe medication, then they may not have the money for that. So it will be important if you can find out if there are any resources in your, whatever you are practicing, to be able to also provide the medication for free.
Secondly, it's important for us to protect our patients' identities, to keep their information confidential. If we don't, their life and their health could be in jeopardy.
I've left the life several times, and he would show up at my job, he would show up at my school, he would threaten to hurt my sisters. So after a while, you just realize it's not worth it.
Maybe leaving right this second isn't the safest way to leave. Maybe we need to take some steps first. Maybe we need to think about kind of, you know, how do you get the person's ID out of the house and make copies and leave it with the service provider so that when they transition, right, what are the, do we need to make sure there's a shelter for them to go to.
If we do provide resources in person, then an ideal way to do this is in a non-written format. The National Sex Trafficking Hotline is 888-3737-888. It is easily memorized, and a patient can walk out of the clinic with that information.
Ideally, if you're at a hospital or a clinic, when we used to do street outreach, we'd give out 1-800 free healthcare cards. Because healthcare kind of isn't one of the things that is seen as like, there's gonna be lots of intervention, and pimps, but they also may call.
Some of these women do have access to cell phones.
The only reason we had phones was because our pimp needed to keep track of us at all times.
While those records might be looked at on a daily basis, a program like Snapchat allows you to text in information and get back information that vanishes then basically in thin air.
So if you're giving them a card or a referral for a service provider who is very clearly kind of an anti-trafficking organization or working with you, maybe write that number down as an x-ray place, or write something else so that they're not taking a number home that could ultimately get them in trouble.
Engaging resources is not a simple process. Many of these patients came to be in these situations through very complicated means, and because they really had no one else to go to. So we as physicians need to have done a thorough assessment of the resources available. We need to understand the risks to our patient. And then we need to connect them with known resources to help them get on that path to recovery.
My vision now is, my eyes are open now. I want to finish school. I want to have a good job. I want to become a nurse. And I honestly, being in the life kind of messes your head with the whole male having a relationship and everything. But I still believe in love. I still want to get married. I want to have kids. I want a normal life.
It's important for us as physicians to provide resources for our patients. If we can't do this in person, then we really need to provide pamphlets and have posters in our clinic that specify resources for sex trafficking.
One thing that has helped me open up over time was seeing pamphlets about sex trafficking and seeing, just reading them in the hospital. I've seen them in hospitals. And it doesn't necessarily make you talk to the doctor right away, but it makes you realize that it is something that people may understand. And it makes you, while reading it, it makes you realize the situation that you're in and the help that is available.
If they are ready to get help, you know, you ask things like, do you want to speak with one of our social workers? Or do you need the phone number of a safe place to stay? Or can I walk you over to the emergency?
I think I let that go on, sorry. Okay, I knew I was gonna go too slow. It's already 2 o'clock and I'm only like 2/3 the way through this. All right, I tried to make up stories about what you guys might see. I don't think I did a very good job. So I really need some audience participation here. So what I was thinking in this is you get called to a fire. How many of you guys are firefighters? Most of you, okay. And so it's this old dilapidated house and in it you find several scantily clad people, really inappropriate. There's snow on the ground and they have basically no clothes on, malnourished. And then along comes somebody who seems to be in charge. And what do you think? What do you do? You manage to get them out of the house and put the fire out, which was your job, right? But so you suspect that this is either a brothel or these kids are being trafficked. What do you do? What do you guys do? And what are your thoughts when you encounter something like that? Who's ever encountered something like that? Okay, I made up something not real. That's where the fires are?
Yeah.
Okay, tell me about that.
I mean, if we see, you know, obviously people that are not related living in an area like that and scantily clad, thin, shivering, it's more often a drug den or somewhere where, you know, there's a group of people using. Usually in that case, I mean, I don't know that we necessarily deal with referrals, but, you know, things like the Red Cross or the Salvation Army is called in to provide for their physical needs, but we don't really do much as far as following up on what's going on there, so.
Okay, see, I needed you guys to help me write my PowerPoint. That was the thing. I made up something not real. So what I was trying to think about was where these kids might be housed. And that you would sort of accidentally uncover them. Did you have something to say? He's been there. He knows what I'm trying to do.
Yeah. Did you happen to read the New Times article that came out a couple of weeks ago about the Child Protective Services, the privatization, and what's been going on?
Yeah.
So I think we're running calls there a lot and not even realizing what's going on. And just like he said up front, just because it's a drug den, we've got our blinders on and don't actually realize what's going on in the places that we're at. So I think what's been happening is we've been missing them, just flat out not thinking about it. Because we're not conditioned to thinking that, you know, that this is even going on, honestly. So one of the lessons my chief taught me a long time ago is you got to think like a bad guy. And that's what they would do. They get them hooked on drugs, put them in a house like that, and then start trafficking them before you know it, they're stuck there. Mm-hmm. And there's nowhere for them to go. So, I mean, just... those are the kind of places that you're going to find them, though.
And that's kind of what I was trying to write about, but clearly I didn't do it very well. So I need to get your name and number, and I'm going to have you help me since we both live in Florida. But yeah, I mean, just think outside the box and think, what could this be? And is there something I'm missing? I guarantee you that you've had these experiences where you think there's something else going on, but then you get called to do something else and don't have time to finish up on it, right? Don't have time to follow up. We all have those experiences. I'm sure your jobs are insanely busy, sometimes very dangerous, and you know you have to solve the problem and move on to the next one. Is that right?
Plus, I think that, you know, if you're telling us that they don't respond well to police, our first thing is that we turn them over to the police department.
Right.
And then, you know, we don't really get involved in anything after that. And if they clam up with the police officer at that point, then they're not going to get the help that they need. So I think this is great that we need to realize that, and that was a great teaching point for us, that they don't respond well to the police department, because that's our first, you know, avenue of, let me turn them over.
Well,
now, if we're transporting them to the hospital, I guess my question was, if we're transporting the hospital, how many doctors are actually really prepped to
you know, for me to walk in and say, you know, this is what I think. And, you know, sometimes we get better response from nurses. I don't even know if it's in curriculum yet for nurses. And
those are really good points. Thank you. I'm going to try to address some of them. Number one, doctors are not very well educated and I hate to bash my own profession. Seemingly not terribly interested. They think that it's not their responsibility. The nurses are doing a much better job in their training and are much more responsive. I actually enjoy speaking to nurse practitioners more than I enjoy speaking to physicians. And I was really excited about coming here because I thought, this is a new audience. I'm going to learn something. And maybe these are the people that can make a bigger difference. And I agree with you. I don't see the police as bad guys. I really don't, at least not most of the time, right? I see them as good guys. It doesn't scare me when I see a cop, but that's our perspective, right? We grew up differently, and they're part of your world, right? They're probably your friends, right? You know these people. You interact with them all the time. But these kids don't have the same perspective, and we need to somehow get through to them. Yes?
So I guess my question would be, if you do have one of these victims that come forward, do they go after the controllers or the pimps or whatever you want to call them? Are they sought after by the authorities, or what happens? Because it seems like sometimes, just from hearing that even in your own stories, that they, you know, the controllers will come back and get them and, you know, take them. So why don't they go after those guys, I guess?
Well, we're trying. And I think that, the FBI and Homeland Security, I mean, have really done a good job over the last 5 or so years of trying to revamp the process, creating laws, really reaching out to people. I think in general, the process has started and we're doing a good job. But I think this campaign is kind of in its infancy still. Maybe we're approaching toddlerhood. But I think we're doing a better job than we did before. When you call an abuse report, so say you need to call. Say you've identified somebody that you think you need to make a phone call. You know it's a minor. You know they're being trafficked. You know it in your gut. You're a mandatory reporter. You have to pick up the phone and call. Rather than calling the police, you may call the abuse hotline in whatever state you live in. If you say, I think I have a human trafficking victim, it puts this call down a different protocol than just child abuse. So that might help. I don't have all the answers. I'm here to try to find some and to try to get more people on my side to help. Yes?
So as we're talking about this, I guess one of the questions I have is, are you talking about a one or two child incident in a home, or are we looking for multiples?
It really depends. So that's a really good question. So she's talking about like isolated, you know, one or two kids in a home versus big trafficking rings, and it spans all of that. Some of it's organized crime. Some of it we need to be careful of because we don't want to get sucked into that. We don't want to put ourselves or our families in danger. That's very real. It's not as common. A lot of this is mom and pop organizations. My first known dealing with victims of trafficking was in 2008, 2009 in Tallahassee, Florida. I'm sure that I dealt with it before and was not aware of it, didn't recognize it, because when I started talking to these women, I realized, oh, wait, I've seen people like this before, and I didn't realize what it was. But these two women that I cared for were in a shelter, and so I made the assumption that they were victims of domestic violence, like everyone else that was living there, but their stories felt different, and their demeanor was different, and I started asking questions. And they were actually foreign nationals. They'd been, one of them brought up from Guatemala, the other one from El Salvador, but they had been trafficked in with the promise of being like domestics in a household, and then they were sex trafficked and moved all the way every 2 weeks from the Texas border all the way around the Gulf of Mexico, along the panhandle there in Texas, Louisiana, all the way around. Every couple of weeks and moved from camp to camp to camp for 2 years. They escaped because their trafficker in Tallahassee forgot to lock the door one day, and these women who didn't have any clothes went running through the neighborhood, actually in one of the nicer neighborhoods in town, knocking on all the doors to try to get somebody to respond. About the third or fourth door, somebody opened the door. But what he was doing was he was driving them to the houses and pimping them out, and it was all North Tallahassee. It was all the nicer part of town. So they weren't going down on the south side of town where, you know, all the poverty-stricken areas and not-so-nice areas. It was all in the wealthier part of town. So that was my first encounter. And these women who didn't really speak English, and I didn't really speak very good Spanish, we cobbled together a story, mostly with sign language. And I got their story, over about 6 or 7 months of seeing them every week. And they were in shelter, and so they had food and they had a place to live, but they didn't trust anyone. And the people that were running the shelter didn't want me to ask them questions. I said, that's what I do. I ask people questions, ask lots of questions. So I don't know that there's one easy answer. I think you're going to see all sorts of different things, and you're going to see kids being trafficked and being house slaves. In South Florida, that's been a big problem. They broke up a big ring in South Florida a couple years ago, and that was what they were finding, was these kids were being enslaved by some of the wealthier clients. They weren't going to school, and that's how they found out. Kid had a fracture, and yes, I'm sorry, I didn't see you.
So with your program, have you tried to implement it in the school systems, in the middle schools, or a similar program to this in the middle schools?
We haven't, but success? There are people that are, and we have materials. I've got materials for you guys back here that I printed from the Department of Homeland Security and brought for you because they thought they might be useful for you. We are willing to go out and talk to anybody, but I think we need to get everybody involved. And yes, educating the kids when they're young and the teachers in the early grades will probably make a bigger difference because they'll see it and they'll recognize when something's wrong.
I agree. My wife's been an advocate for this, so it's kind of interesting. I've had no exposure to this. Didn't realize it was a huge problem, especially in Virginia and where I'm from. It is a issue, and she's tried to push it into the middle schools, and the school system doesn't want to have anything to do with it right now.
I think
they're just one of those things where they're afraid to, and even the police department only has one person assigned to it, and they don't really track trafficking. They usually categorize it as something else, as an assault or something. This is one of those problems. I'm not sure they want to, how much resources they want to put into it once you open up Pandora's box, so to speak, and how much money and all that they want to invest into it. But she's been trying to push it in the school systems, and they won't let her. So she's been doing it to church groups, something similar to what you're doing. But I'd like to see if I get some information that I could use to bring back to her to try to reach out to the prevention. You need to get to the schools, because we're seeing the middle school students is where they're targeting right now and where we live. Mm-hmm. And these people go to the malls and stuff, and they're actually picking these kids out of the malls
exactly. Day
in and day out. And the police department, they have limited resources. They know it's a problem, but they haven't done anything about it.
I would love to talk to you after the session's over and to exchange contact information, and love to talk to your wife and see if we can get some materials. And that's the same for everybody. If you've got specific needs, I'm living in Florida now, so I can't go everywhere, but I can find people in your communities who would be willing to come and talk to you, whatever group you have in mind. I do think it's important to engage community groups, and faith-based groups are often right on top of this and willing to engage and help educate. I think whatever we can do, and to recognize these kids early. Okay, so my case presentation failed, but it led to a very interesting discussion. Thank you. So Kanani in the video really talked about some of these questions, and I just want to reiterate, asking them where they live, and that question, do you sleep, eat, and work all in the same place? It sounds contrived, but people don't do that, right? Most of us go somewhere else to work. And so if you find that, then you should be concerned. Sarah in the video talked about how her sisters had been threatened, and that's actually really common. I know where your family lives. I know who your siblings are. If you run away, I'm just gonna go get your little sister. And that happens all the time. All right, so these are the resources for victims. So the 888-3737-888, it's a really easy number to remember if somebody's not high. But they can also text Be Free. If they use Snapchat, where it goes away immediately, then they can use that texting mechanism and not be discovered by their trafficker. But then they'll have to be savvy enough to uninstall Snapchat on their phone so that their trafficker doesn't know it's there. And then the number for the international, the foreign nationals, is different. It's 886-872-4973. I'll make these slides available so that, and the videos. So if you guys want to use them in any capacity in the future, feel free. Okay, I made another lame attempt at creating a scenario. The point I'm trying to make here is big sporting events are huge sex trafficking venues. So the Super Bowl that was in New Orleans or Houston a number of years ago, was there a Super Bowl in Houston? Feels like there was. There was some, Dallas. It's the biggest sex trafficking event globally that's ever been seen. But, you know, these kids, these women, these men, they get shipped in. Lots of the hotel workers get sucked into this and forced into trafficking, sex trafficking during big sporting events. So if you've got some big event like that in your community, be thinking this could be part of the problem. I might be seeing this weekend. And that was the point of this scenario. However, I was having trouble with it. I just don't go out on calls. Anybody have any thoughts about that one? Here's another one. I'm just going to skip these. And then I'm going to get together with you guys and you can give me some real ones. If you decide you're going to make that call to a social worker, to the abuse hotline, to the police, have some sense of what you're going to say before you pick up that phone. I know you all do, but you're in a big hurry. I would really advocate for calling the abuse hotline and saying, I have a potential human trafficking victim. I really think that's the most powerful way. They are mandated to use a different protocol now. And I will check into what happens in Virginia later today. I'm pretty sure that's what happens here, but I'm not sure. I think I'm almost done with time. Yes. Well, you have to pay attention to your own state laws, but you know, everybody's a minor under 18, so you are a mandatory reporter.
Right, and I mean to say, is 18 like the dead cutoff? What if somebody's sucked into it and they're 20?
It gets trickier.
They lose their ability to intervene, I guess?
Not necessarily. So if you think they're a victim of human trafficking, there are different protocols. All the state laws are different. And so it really depends on where you live. The trafficking laws are all posted on the Polaris Project website, and they're updated about once a month. Anytime there's a change in the law, it's updated. And you can search by state so that you know what your own state laws are. But there are different protocols in place. The problem with some of the new laws making trafficking a reportable offense and making you a mandatory reporter as opposed to domestic violence, which in most states you are not a mandatory reporter for that if the person is between 18 and 60 and not disabled in some capacity, right? But there's no funding, which is part of the problem that you're having in Virginia. So we have new laws in Florida, but there was no funding for it. So it's difficult. We've got some really good trafficking coalitions, but there's no money behind most of it. So it's a lot of it's privately funded.
So in Florida, as an example, 18 is the number?
Mm-hmm. Okay. I want to talk a little bit. I know we're, how close are we? We have 6 minutes, or maybe one, depending on when I'm supposed to get off the stage.
2:30.
Okay. So there was a New York Times editorial this week talking about the legalization of prostitution. Did anybody read that? No? Well, this topic bothers me, and so I thought, well, I'm going to have a different audience today, and I'm going to ask some questions about what you guys think about this. So what do you think about that? So New Zealand now has passed a law that there's decriminalization of prostitution. That carries with it some different issues. But what are your thoughts about that? Seriously. Yes.
I think that, you know, to me, a 16-year-old female, there's something that potentially something, if they're into, you know, drugs or something, maybe that's the way they get their habit. Maybe this one is into drugs too, like you said, that's how they get them stuck in there too. But I don't know, there's a, to me it just seems like a red flag.
What if she's 12? Yeah, I agree.
When you start living outside the United States, you go any country, it's horrible. They start at ages 8, 9, 10, so. I mean,
and do you think that's a choice?
Absolutely not a choice.
When is it a choice?
You know, the thing I see here, the word that stands out to me is decides. You know, does that mean she's making this decision herself, you know, which removes it from this decision being made for her? But then that also brings up the question is,
right. I think this is a tough issue. I really think it is. And I think that, so when I first started talking to physicians about trafficking, and you know, you cross that age of 18 barrier where someone is theoretically a child and then on one day they're an adult, which we know it's not a black and white issue. I find it hard to believe that any little boy or little girl grows up saying, I want to be a prostitute. Right? They might say, I want to be a firefighter. They might say, I want to be a paramedic. They might say, I want to be a doctor. But they don't grow up saying, I want to be a prostitute. If they make a choice to enter into the sex trade, it usually means they don't have other choices in their life. That's what I think. That's my opinion. A lot of people share that opinion, and a lot of people don't. But this move to legalize prostitution, I think carries with it some inherent risks. And one of the arguments that was posted in the New York Times, it was a kind of a debate editorial in the New York Times, and one of the people was suggesting that decriminalizing prostitution would make trafficking less profitable, and so maybe part of it would go away. But I have trouble with that because it's a different mechanism. And so I really wanted to know what you guys thought about it. Yeah.
Well, I think even if it is possible for, I think it's dehumanizing, but I think even if it is possible for somebody to do it as an adult in such a way it's that we have to allow them to make that choice, even if that's possible, just the whole, just have the industry, just the nature of the industry is so susceptible to abuse and all these things, and I think we as public, you know, public safety officers, and we need all the tools we can to be able to intervene and decriminalize and only ties our hands. I mean, I think we can certainly move away from the type of perspective that looks to punish prostitutes, but we shouldn't give their pence any rules of it at all.
I agree with you completely. Thank you for saying that, so I didn't have to say that. Okay, I know that I've got a bunch of slides on health outcomes, but you guys are not seeing people. You do see people repetitively, though, don't you? Your first example was somebody that you'd seen multiple times. So I'll just quickly run through this. I know I'm out of time. Is there somebody in this room right at 2:30?
No, but they're coming in at 3, and they have to set up for the
same thing. All right. Okay, so just again, that most people that have been trafficked have been sexually abused, and even if they're not trafficked even if they're not sex trafficked, say they're labor trafficked, they've been subject to sexual violence while they were being trafficked. And most of these folks report that they've never had any personal freedom, ever. Not just during the time they were trafficked. And when they present for healthcare, they usually have lots and lots of problems, and PTSD is one of them, making it just that much more complicated. There's also a lot of closed head injuries and a lot of multiple injuries, but the closed head injuries make it more difficult to get a history and more difficult for patients to be adherent to healthcare if you can find a problem and try to intervene. And so that makes delivering the healthcare more challenging. It probably makes it more difficult for all of you in the field too. Minors who've been sex trafficked commit suicide at a really high rate. They attempt suicide at a really high rate, and they have lots of injuries related to the violence. Girls who are sex trafficked when they're 8, 9 years old, like you're mentioning, have multiple gynecologic injuries and a lot of fistulas, so they may have rectovaginal fistulas and all sorts of pelvic injuries. It's also the leading cause of death is homicide, because these kids get killed if they're trying to leave or causing problems, and they also have a really high incidence of HIV infections and then subsequent AIDS because they didn't get health care. I'm going to skip past this because we've talked a lot about it. Traffickers in the United States do tend to take their, I'll call them slaves, for dental care pretty frequently, because prettier girls and boys bring in more money, and so they fix their teeth. We've been talking about this all day, so I'm going to skip it. I took this picture at the airport when I was coming in. This is a billboard by the Blue Campaign, which is the Department of Homeland Security. They've been in the anti-trafficking movement for 5 years now. I got in trouble for taking this picture, by the way. I got yelled at. You can't stop there. Well, what if I needed to write the number down? That's what I said. My husband's, of course, waiting beside me. I don't think they believed me that I needed to write the number down. I've got resources for all of you, and I will give these slides to Beverly so that anybody who wants them can have them. You can also give me your email address, and I'll just send you the file if that's what you want. Tons of references. I know they're too small to see, but if you like to read and you want to see where I got my research, there it is.